Welcome back to our Love Challenge. My name is Michelle Jackson. I'm the lead pastor here at Hope Christian Church, and we're so grateful that you're here with us today. I want to get straight into today's topic, which is worship. The love we have for God is reflected in how we worship Him, the fervency of our worship, but also our commitment to bring others in to knowing the true and living God. So I wanted to go to John chapter 4 today. I want us to go there together. I'm going to tell you the story of the woman at the well. Many of us know that the Bible tells us that Jesus had to go through Samaria, that it wasn't the fastest way for him to get to where he was going, but he had to go this way. And he had an encounter with a woman who was spiritual, who knew things about the coming king, the coming Messiah, but was still living a life that was full of brokenness and shame and regret and even public humiliation. And so when Jesus encountered this woman, he was the well sitting on the well, as preachers tell us, right? He was offering her a cup of living water that would give her eternal life. And she began to believe him by faith. How is this tied to love? Let's talk about that. I want to emphasize verse 13 to you. Jesus replied to her, "Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again." He was talking about the water in the actual well. But then he says in verse 14, "But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." Well, this got this woman very intrigued, and she asked him for this water. And that's what happens when we worship God. Our love for him grows, and our capacity to share the message of Jesus grows. We spend intimate time with the Lord in worshiping, basking in his presence, allowing him to declare to us who he is. We have a deeper knowing of who God is, because worship is not a song, although it can be a song. Worship is an attitude. It's a heart posture where we are in the presence of God and we are able to adore him, to love on him. And so I want you to know that even your giving, your act of generosity, of tithe and offering, sowing into the poor, extending yourself in service, how you use your gifts and talents are acts of worship, acts of love and service to God. And so we are going to look at verse 23 because this really was the linchpin that caused this woman. Not only did he know everything about her life, but this was the linchpin in her becoming one who could share with others, saying, "Come see a man." Let's look at verse 23 together. That's where I want to start. And you can go line by line if you're not familiar with this story, but most people are familiar with the woman at the well. All right, verse 23. "But the time is coming, indeed it is now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. For God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." So what does this mean when it comes to love? Love is God and God is love. And so if we're going to operate in the love of God, we have to understand that we not only have to know God's word, his truth, his way, but also operate in the spirit, operate in the spirit of love that allows us to move beyond our flesh, move beyond the patterns of sin, move beyond the patterns of the way that the world works, where retribution and vindication are the things that we seek after to promote ourselves, self-exaltation, where we begin to worship ourselves, but we become those that are humble. We become those who operate in love as we submit ourselves to the Lord. And that is what worship looks like to the Father. The Father wants to receive our worship as a sweet smelling savor. Say that three times fast. Sweet smelling savor. He wants our worship to be an incense that he can breathe in and that he can say, yes, this smells like my son. This smells like Jesus. This doesn't smell like the world. It doesn't smell polluted. It doesn't smell like fornication. It doesn't smell like all of the things that people deal with in life. It doesn't smell like pettiness. Whatever the issue may be for you, it doesn't smell like those things. It smells like my son. It smells like they understand the truth of who I am and that they are learning to walk in the Spirit. So here's a question for you today about love and worship. You ready? What kind of food did Jesus eat? And the story, right? Because remember, Jesus had to go through Samaria and his disciples left him alone, and he shouldn't have been alone with this lady. However, they had left to get food. So go to verse 32. But Jesus replied, I have the kind of food you know nothing about. So he received nourishment, verse 34 tells us, as you go on, that he received nourishment, he received sustenance, he received strength by doing the will of God who has sent him and by completing the task. That was his nourishment. That was his food. That's what kept him going, because he was moving in a rhythm that was set by the pace of the Father. He was walking in the Spirit. He was on a spiritual mission. He was not concerned about Mickey D's or Chick-fil-A or whatever you like to eat. He was concerned about completing the mission and the assignment that God had sent him on. And we know that it was purposed for him to go through Samaria based on these verses. So why is this important? This is important because Samaria was not the people necessarily that Jesus was sent to. He was sent to the lost sheep of Israel. And the Samaritans knew about the Jewish religion. There were religious sites there. They knew some of the things that that the Jewish people believed. But you have to remember that near Samaria, there was a place called Sidon, and that's where Jezebel came from, and a lot of the Baal worshipers and the Asherah worshipers and those that worshiped pagan gods. And so Samaria was a place of mixture, but Jesus came to give this woman and the people there, because the Bible tells us he stayed there for 2 days. So he came there to give them a call to purity, a call to sanctification, a call to truth, a call to know him truly by the Spirit. And so it's so important that we recognize that the worship that he received from this woman, because he was telling her, you're going to have to worship the Father in spirit and in truth, meaning you're not going to be able to give mixture. You're not going to be able to take a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And she declared from her own mouth that she knew the Messiah was coming. So you have to understand, Jesus was satisfied and the Father was satisfied from worship. So if you're ever wondering, how can I satisfy God? How can I bless him? How can I ever give him something that he would be pleased with? You can give the Lord worship. So let me pray with you. Father, I thank you that you're growing our capacity to love you, not just for the things that you do for us, but who you are. Lord, you're showing us how to connect this attitude and this heart posture of love to our worship, to our service, to the things that we do. We know that we work as unto you and not unto man, and that favor does not come from man, and that promotion doesn't come from the north, the south, or the east, or the west, but it comes directly from you. And so, Lord, today we're asking that you show us how to grow our capacity to love you through worship, to love you through service, to love you through giving to others, so that others may know that you are the well that does not run dry, that you are the true source of the peace, of the affirmation, of the confidence, of the acceptance that they are looking for. And we thank you, Lord, that just as you had to go to visit this woman, Lord, we know that there are divine appointments for us every day and that there are people that you're asking us not to pass by. So Lord, we ask that our feet would hasten to do what is good, that our feet would hasten to be in the center of your will, and we'll be careful to give you the glory and the praise for what you're doing in and through our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So this was awesome. We're going to talk about the woman at the well next time a little bit more, and I know you're going to be blessed. So between now and then, read John chapter 4 And I'll meet you here next time in our Love Challenge. Be blessed.